One of the things I've noticed, one of the things across the decades, I was going to say 5 decades, but I think it's probably about 6 that I've been on the road, and is volume of hair. Yes, volume of hair, but volume of sound. And the first amplifier I ever had, I made myself actually, and I remember a jet of flame going up from the plug in my father's study. Hard to explain and to handle. And I think I was unconscious for about a minute. But when I was 14, I was lucky enough to buy myself a Vox AC 30 watt amplifier. And if you set that in the middle of the stage here now, it would be pretty loud. But by the time it got around to about 19, but so I had that when I joined the Moodies, and I used it for recording all the way through. I think it actually might be in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame now, and I'll go and look up his memory. I always wonder whether you should have parted with these things. But when about 1968, I think I had to step up a bit, so I had a 50 watt Marshall with a 4x12 cabinet. And then recently I was looking at some photographs from the Isle of Wight Festival in 1970, and I noticed that behind me I had a 200 watt high watt amplifier with a 200 watt slave, and then John had the same, another 400 watts, and then Mike Pinder on Mellotron, he had another 800 over there to make the whole thing kind of symmetrical. And even our drummer Graham had got round to having amplification then with his huge trumpet. But I know we were pretty loud and I could feel my flares flapping on the low note. I made that bit up. And then in about 1970-71, we met a young man, an electronics engineer called Gene Clare, up in Lancaster, Pennsylvania. And he built us the most brilliant sound system. And then we were really, really, really loud, because we had to fill these places that we were playing. We didn't notice it, but we were going up in numbers of audience and people as well in the Moodies. But it took me about until the 1980s to realize that if we had such a fabulous sound system, we could come back in volume or gain, as I think the Americans, that took me by surprise when I first came to America. Volume in England was gain in America, neither of which word, for me personally, describes sound. Was it? Volume or sound, yes? Okay, help me out, Jesus. It doesn't really. But there it is. It's written on the amp, so that's what we did. And but it took me about until the 1980s to realise that if we had such a fabulous sound system, we could come back in level on stage. And I came back to using my Vox AC30 and one of these little Fender amplifiers that Mike is using as a... He's showing us and using us as a seat right now. And I think sonically in the Moody Blues, the 80s were probably the best we've ever been.
Yes.
And so... But I haven't got to the end yet. It wasn't until I met Mike that I realised that actually what I wanted to do really was to play these beautiful acoustic guitars. And so I'm back to about when I was 13 now. But in the 1980s was a particularly favourite decade of mine, musically, for lots of things that were going on in the music world and to be in London. And to have some success with the band and with songs in the 1980s was really magical, because we had a song called Your Wildest Dreams, and then another one called I Know You're Out There Somewhere. And I was 39 when Wildest Dreams came out. And because I kind of missed the 60s. I knew I was there. I've seen the photographs. I knew. But my mind was elsewhere. swear, chemically, mystically, and emotionally all the time. But the 1980s, I think, there's so many songs from that time that there's a couple that we'd like to, let's put it this way, there's a couple that we'd like to do now that really never got any airplay and nobody really took any notice, I don't think. But they're favourites of mine and we'd like to do these for you now. And the first one of these is called Vintage Wine. Children's prayer, the laughing eyes.